This program is one of the earliest public access productions in the world, created by the citizens and community of Aspen, Colorado, for the Grassroots Network. Please consider contributing to the restoration and preservation of 200 other Grassroots Network videotapes from the early 1970s. This motion picture record of life, history, and politics in Aspen and the Roaring Fork Valley is in critical need of permanent digital preservation. Please contact John Masters, Executive Director, at 970-925-8000 with your pledge toward this community archive project. The digital restoration and preservation of this program was made possible by generous contributions from John and Catherine Smith, Linda Maslow, Randy Bean, and Andy Stone, and a matching grant from the National Endowment for the Arts in collaboration with the Bay Area Video Coalition, San Francisco.
This episode of the Grassroots Video Archive Series features an interview with Aspen legend Ralph Jackson, followed by a taping of the early Grassroots show Issues, where George Madsen of the Aspen Times interviews Aspen City Manager Leon Wuerl and Vail City Manager Terry Minger and asks the question, who do you work for, full-time residents or developers? Then we go to the streets of Aspen for a segment titled Say It, where the citizens of Aspen get to take the mic and talk about whatever's on their minds. The beginning and end of this episode features two video art pieces produced for Grassroots in 1972.
Thank you. This is Grassroots Network, cablecasting in Aspen, Colorado on Channel 12. Grassroots is community video. It is supported by members of the community who are interested in developing television as a valuable community resource in Aspen. This is Grassroots' last show of the summer 1972 season. We will be off the air from September 1st to November 1st. This break is to give the Grassroots crew a rest and to give us a chance to get the equipment repaired. However, Grassroots will continue to seek financial support and programming ideas during the off-season. If there is anything you can contribute to our winter series, either ideas, talent, or money, please get in touch at 925-4215 or at Box 2006, Aspen. We are a tax-exempt corporation, and all of our staff are volunteers. This week, in addition to our regular features, Issues and Say It, we present a feedback experiment by Ed Thorne and an interview with Ralph Jackson by Linda Maslow. This week on Access, beginning at 6 p.m. every evening, we have an interview by Bill Dunaway with Floyd Haskell and a surrealistic special called Stairway to the Stars, produced for Grassroots by the Abstraction League. Grassroots would like to give a big hug and say thanks to all the Aspenites who have contributed to Grassroots so generously this summer. Remember, all you Edge of Ajax fans, all 8 episodes plus Ed Thorne's tape on the shooting of the last episode are now being transferred to film and will be playing at your neighborhood theater very soon. The date and place will be announced later. We're sitting here on the running board of a 1937 Chevrolet which belongs to Ralph Jackson. Ralph, I understand you're some kind of a legend in this town. Why don't you tell us a little about that?
Well, really, some kind of a something or other, anyway. Start off by saying that I came here for my health from the service days. Sort of grew on me and made a lot of friends here, and this is home. And I think I have brought some happiness to many people through my efforts on the slope in the form of figure skiing, shall we say. And although I am not an alcoholic, I have become an aspaholic. And this is home, and even though I don't like a lot of things that are happening with the growth that's taking place here, it's going on all over the country, and certainly it's inevitable that it should happen here. So in the meantime, I'm planning and looking forward to getting a reservation lined up for a moon flight and hoping to get away from this hodgepodge of humanity. In the meantime, again, as I say, this skiing is kind of contagious, and it kind of gets under your collar, and it's hard to give it up. I try to stay away, but I find when I go out in a strange town or, say, visiting out in the cities elsewhere, that the uptightness of the people is unpleasant, and you just don't dare to be yourself and be friendly. And unfortunately, that feeling is taking place up here in Aspen now with these new people coming in. people are in from the cities who haven't adjusted don't know about the small town way of life and the friendly attitudes, so that I have to be careful not to be too outgoing and speak to people too freely, because they are uptight and they haven't adjusted. Perhaps after they've been here a while, they will. If we don't build up too much here, perhaps they will adjust to the country way of doing things and might be friendlier.
Tell us about your underground ski school.
Well, the underground ski school is something that got started as a result of the fact that I got out of the service on a medical, and I did teach legit, should we say, in the beginning, and I was on the ski patrol for a while, and after having helped to make some of the ski trails and all, and engage in some promotional efforts, but I got in to teach underground in sort of a friendly way, because I wasn't really taking much for my efforts. It was just a friendly thing while I was getting back in shape. And then gradually, as I got to feel better, I got to do more trick skiing. And being a figure skater originally, I'm really figure skiing. And it's a challenge for me to go on the slope and try to execute some of the figures that we do on the ice rink. And unfortunately, some certain individuals have made like an underground deal, but they, I think, it's kind of spoiled their chances by trying too hard to make money, perhaps to make more than some legitimate instructors who are in there really working as a group. And by trying to make more and bragging about it, I'm afraid they didn't help themselves too much, because these other fellows in the regular ski school had to make a living, and they had to click their heels and be out in all kinds of weather and all that jazz, which is another reason why I didn't go stay with the ski school, by the way, because I couldn't take the bad weather. And demonstrating over and over was too much for me, so that's about it. And the underground, it's just now, winds up as being an entertainment thing where I teach, just demonstrate trick skiing and costume, and especially for the children who enjoy it, and provides a source of fun for them. And it's, I find, a very pleasant thing for me to do, because I like children and they like me, and that means a lot to the children like you. And it's encouraging to them, and also to grown-ups who come out here learning to ski, to see someone perhaps older than they are executing different tricks on skis, such as turning around and skiing backwards and doing they've told me themselves that they found it very encouraging as well as entertaining. So it's gratifying to me in this respect.
What kind of reaction do you get from older people?
Well, they're amused when they see me doing these things, and lots of times they tell me that they are quite concerned when they first see me for the first time coming down the slope, especially with the outfit, my black coat and top hat. Well, how did I pick out this outfit? I found this fur coat one summer day out at the city dump, hanging on a post. And needless to say, it was in a little better shape than it is now. And so I could, looking ahead a bit, a few months, I decided that would be a nice thing to wear, especially going up on the lift on a cold day.
I don't know how old you are, but I think that you've got a really young head and obviously a young body. You're a really super skier. You do Royal Christies and 180s. You enter the hot dog contest every year. What's your secret?
I'll show you. Well, it's, I feel perhaps that I'm trying to make up for lost time in the service and through my health. That I've been here, as I said before, for my health. And so I determined to build myself up and try to catch up and make up for the years that I've lost by through watching my diet and exercising and a mental outlook. And being naturally, well, sort of a clown, I like to amuse and entertain, especially the children that need encouragement, and as well as grown-ups. And there is so much tenseness in the world, so much tension and unhappiness in good many instances, that I feel that someone should try to help or lighten things a little bit. And although there's so much hate, we have too much hate in the world, and we need more love. And so by that, I don't want to be misconstrued with my fellow hippies. By the way, I'm mistaken for the head of the hippies sometimes, as well as the director of the underground ski school. But so much lovemaking going on there. I'm not condemning them. I might be a little envious, but I think the world needs more love and different types and grades and volume and et cetera. So I try in my way to bring up the fun side of the thing and encourage others. That's maybe too much but we really need more of it. There's we have new people coming into skiing now that don't know what it's all about, really. Everyone's traveling and taking up sports, and so many of them get started off in too serious a vein, I feel. So I think by lightening it a little bit with a little trick stuff now and then, I think it's going to help to encourage people, let them see that it isn't a case of outdoing or being better than someone else as so much as it is just getting in there and having a good time, enjoying it with groups together. Another thing is the cross-country skiing, I'd like to say, is it goes back to the early days of skiing, of course, but it goes back for me. In New England, I was under cross-country skiing, and it was really, really, I think, a better form of skiing because we'd go out with groups and picnic out in the countryside in the early season, right on through in the spring. Go out for a day or for a weekend. We'd take the snow trains or we'd go out in out of Boston, that sort of thing. And I used to take groups of Girl Scouts through my contacts with engineers who were married and their families and just go out for fun, have a good time. And I think this cross-country skiing is a good way, as an ideal means of bringing families together more on the slope rather than have them go up on the hill and just try to ski faster or better than their pals. Well, I've had to do this for years for myself, but I wasn't too healthy as a youngster. I've been fighting for my health for all these years, and I've been more encouraged now to the, with more people getting into it now due to the fact that foods are so in, denatured and you have enriched bread and things like that, and the goodness is taken out. So we have to look for the, you have to go back to the source of things now. Organic foods are important now. Getting the growing things in organic soil is more important now than ever because we're losing all the goodness in the soil through all these pesticides and failure to build the soil up over a period of years. And well, that's just my hobby, let's say, to take care of my health. I don't drink much, and I think fortunately, well, they're getting down on smoking, and now they're starting to get down on drinking. Alcohol is bad, and any quantity. Unfortunately, it's gotten to be the big thing. Everyone's brainwashed into these things, and but gradually they're finding out because I think the fact that food is so poor and lacking in the things the body requires that they have to, they're driven to give up drinking. It certainly is not tapering off or leveling off. It's in fact, when I look from here up on the hillside and see earth movers moving around, digging into the hillside, and up in Independence Pass as well as on Red Mountain, it's just a big thing now. one of our friends who wrote a letter just the other last week in the paper about it and trying to stop it, but you can't stop it. The machine is rolling, the old deal is rolling now, the ball is rolling down the hill, and it's like a big snowball rolling down the hill, and you just can't stop it. It's got all the real estate people in there, and people that we've advertised, so they're all coming out here as well as other places, and there's so many more people, this population explosion. And we just can't do much about it now, but just try to adjust. People finding out about the climate, how ideal it is compared to where they come from and all. So fortunately, they are building down the valley and out there out of Steamboat Springs. There's a big development going on so that they can get places going up outside. It just so happens that we're hemmed in by the mountains here, so that it's more obvious and it's harder to adjust to because we're brought together more closely. But with developments going on down the valley, why, and up and back, why, that'll help a lot to absorb the people.
Do you think you'll stick around? Well,
I think of getting away, but I ask myself, where can one go to anymore? every place is crowded, and I like Mexico, and I like to get down there and spend more time down there, but it's getting crowded, and in Canada might offer something to get up into the wilderness and get up into the country, possibly Europe and some of the small towns. But I sort of joke about going into putting in for the moon flight, getting in on that's being done now. People are putting in for reservations, but I don't want to go up there and just look for a good corner lot to start, for a gas station or anything like that. I just hope that through snorkeling and that sort of thing and just getting out of the country further as we get crowded in here, that we can find some compensation, some way around it. That's what I hope and pray for.
Are you going to be running an underground ski school this winter?
I don't conduct in the usual original sense of the word. I don't teach skiing now. I have people asking me, they want to go because they want to be casual. But I cooperate with the ski school not because I have received a lifetime pass, but because I can stay away and like find a good beach resort somewhere for the winter. But just because I feel it shouldn't interfere with the legitimate setup. I'm not playing ball necessarily with anyone. It's just logical to me, it seems, to let the original deal continue, and because they're handling beginners and intermediate and advanced, and then I could, if I wanted to, I could take on and tell people and teach them trick skiing, but I don't approve of that. I don't think that we should teach too many people to get out and do trick skiing because of the hazard. I figure skated so much, I can stop in the middle of a turn without hurting anyone, but other people getting out and teaching it. It would mean that too many people getting out there on the slope that wouldn't know how to stop to avoid going into a class of, a ski class or a group of skiers. I think that it's better to just go along and entertain. So I'll just continue to entertain and try to amuse and show people that they can have fun skiing. And that encourage more loving attitude, by the way. We have too much hate around in the country, and I won't particularly mention any place in particular. But that's my observation, because I like people, and I've been here a while, and I expect to be around a long time in a happy way, I hope. Thank you. Pleasure, dear. I hope that I've done some good help to bring a good slant on the skiing scene insofar as fun is concerned. Fun and love and all its embracing meaning. Fun and love.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is George Madsen. I'm a reporter for the Aspen Times. And our guests tonight are two men I feel are the real bosses of the notable resort communities of Aspen and Vail. They're the city managers of those communities. I claim that they're at least 51% responsible for the way things run in their various towns. Of course, they're not responsible for setting policy, but they do suggest policy. And perhaps even more important, they carry out policy, sometimes at their own discretion. So the question is, which way are they running? And who are they running for? Residents, permanent residents, that is, or the non-residents, such as tourists and developers? My guests are Leon Wuerl, Aspen City Manager, and Terry Minger, Vail Town Manager. I think I should note that Vail, as it's known in the greater Minturn Red Cliff area, is a little way down the road from Dotsero. Terry, it's on the road to Benkelman, Nebraska, as I remember. Well, gentlemen, I assume that you agree with my statement that you actually run your communities. Leon?
I agree with that, George. Of course, it's under the guidelines and policies established by the council, but then I think that's true.
Terry?
Yes, I think some people in my community may disagree with me, but I think overall we're responsible, yes.
Then what do you feel is your most important function? And may I add, why do you think it's your most important function?
Well, I think that changes from time to time, George. I think my most important function now, I feel, is to assist the council in establishing the priorities for the city.
Terry?
I see my role and function perhaps as acting as a catalyst in the community to bring people, ideas, and resources together to solve problems.
Do you think your elected representatives, your real bosses, understand your function, Leon?
That's kind of a tough question, but
they're probably listening.
I'm sure they are. I think there are times when they do not understand the function. But basically, I feel that they do. I haven't had any real problems with that. Like I say, it varies from time to time.
Terry?
Every other Tuesday night, I have a feeling that they don't understand our relationship. But on the whole, I think the council of Avondale is a extremely good one, and we work very, very closely together.
Then let me ask, what are your councilmen doing to help you with your job? Do you have frequent rap sessions? Are there other things they do to assist you?
Well, I think the main thing that they do to assist us is to try to understand the problems facing the city and participate in solving those problems. And I feel that our council does that.
Terry?
I think with the council's role can and should be, and I think in my case most of the time is simply to provide some leadership and support for the city manager, and also to provide the manpower and the resources, the material to get the job done that they want to see done.
Leon, do you really care what the average citizen thinks?
Oh, sure.
You listen to him?
Yes, we do. Honestly. Contrary to what they might think, we do.
Terry?
Yes, I think that's what government's all about, particularly local government. I think that in the time when people feel depersonalized and government is very far from them, I think that local government listens more intently and closely than any other unit of government.
Well, you've made yourself out as nice guys. Now let's be more specifically. What do you do specifically to satisfy the average Joe citizen?
Well, of course, once again, that varies. It would start with the very basic thing to do something about a complaint that he has, a street or some minor thing. On the other end of the spectrum, it would be to attempt to get across to the council a high priority item or major item that one or more, or let's say several people, have indicated to me they feel is important. Now, of course, that's a lot more time consuming, and he may not realize the benefit from that as quickly. But if he sees that, that his point is mentioned at some time to the council, then of course it's logical to assume that he feels that that's being accomplished for him.
You are sort of his representative before the council.
Well, that's part of the game. I suppose ideally that function would be performed by the council, but there are several limitations that they have, time being the major one. They're businessmen and maybe gone from the city, and some people would take that opportunity via the city manager, ask him to see that a certain thing was mentioned or so on.
What do you do to satisfy Vailites, Terry?
Well, I agree basically what Leon is saying. I think that my role is to be responsive to citizen and human needs in the communities. And I think, as Leon pointed out, part of the problem in the cities today with a credibility gap that's developing is that if the guy can't get his pothole in front of his house fixed, he's probably not going to buy some esoteric program costing $5 or $6 million to do all kinds of great things in the city. I think you've got to start with the basics. I think you have to be responsive. When Joe Q Citizen calls in the problem, I think you have to respond. You're probably not always in a position to do exactly what he feels should be done, but I think the responsiveness, his knowing that he has an ear, is very, very important.
Do you have potholes in front of your house?
No, I don't. I don't have pavement in front of my house.
Gentlemen, I'd like to ask you what your biggest problem is, and if you'd like to volunteer this information, maybe your second biggest or your third biggest. What is your biggest headache, Leon, as city manager?
Right now, my biggest headache is to try to find or accomplish the defining of the priorities for the community. It sets up a very frustrating situation for a city manager when the goals and priorities are not well defined. Now, I think that we're making some inroads in that area, but that is the single biggest problem at the moment.
May I offer just a little amendment there? Perhaps your problem really is defining who you should listen to. That is because you get people on both sides of each question, it seems, huh?
Well, I concur, and I think in Aspen that division is closer maybe than other areas. In the average community, it seems as though the goals are pretty clear. Now, that may be changing. I'm not the city manager any other place.
Aspen is not an average community.
And it does make it tougher here. However, I think there are many items that are clear that could be put into priority and we could push on.
Terry?
I think the biggest problem I'm facing in Vail today is really the growth problem, which sort of transcends the whole ball of wax of governmental services in terms of how do we define growth, how do we cope with it, how do we decide what we as Vail, as a community, as a people, want to be, want to become. It's extremely tough. I think tied into that is probably my second biggest problem, and they may interchange at given times, is the whole concept of developing a sense of community, developing a responsiveness and an awareness on the part of the people in Vail that we are a community like Aspen has been for many years, and we've got to own up to the responsibilities that go hand in hand with being a community, and we've got to grapple with this growth issue, and I think it permeates every facet of my job.
You stole my thunder. That's what I was leading up to, Terry. The growth issue. Both Aspen and Vail were recently lambasted for permitting excessive growth at the Vail Symposium, which considered this question. So I, assuming that you think these the critics of our communities on the growth issue are correct, what can you personally do about this problem? Perhaps what are you doing now? Terry, you've thought about this a good deal.
Well, I think the symposium was an attempt to sit down and perhaps involve people in a community catharsis, if you will, to try to cope with the growth problem. I see specific concrete kinds of things happening. Some of the things that came out of the symposium were a list of criteria and that were geared to responding to growth problems. We've recently formed an ad hoc planning group in the county. Part of the problem that we face in Eagle County is we have unbridled and unrestrained growth in the county. It's really outside our political jurisdiction, but certainly very much in our minds. I see the city council coming out in the very near future with a policy on growth, a policy on development. I think this has to go hand in hand with a statement from Vail Associates in terms of the capacity of the mountain. I think it's all tied into establishing once and for all where the carrying capacities of our tiny Alpine Valley. And once we can establish what those carrying capacities are, I think we can respond and determine what level of the quality of life we'd like to see there.
Sounds like Aspen, doesn't it, Leon?
Certainly does.
What can you do about excessive growth, since your Aspen City Council has just passed a policy statement concerning excessive growth?
Well, my personal role in that, I would feel, would be to suggest and recommend to the Planning Commission or the planners and the council what exactly, from a practical viewpoint, can you do to really control it. And I feel that we have done that. Just how practical it is to invoke what we submitted as a practical approach, I'm not sure. But in fact, the controls lie in what you permit by way of density and so forth on the land. And the only way that I can see that it can be controlled, first is to decide what you want, as Terry pointed out. What will a valley hold from all kinds of sources, water, sewage, and everything that's involved in government? Then set about to rezone the land so that is all that can be permitted. Now, there are a lot of other things that can contribute to helping that, by way of whatever size sewer plants you design, to how many policemen you're willing to hire, and how much water you're willing or can supply, and so on. But I feel that's the decision that has to be made, and it's a tough one. You're going to be dealing with the economic balance of the valley, so to speak, because you're going to say to one rancher he can have 3 houses per 10 acres, and the next one might dictate 1 on 50 acres.
But since our time is up, would it be fair just to summarize to say that at least now the problem is recognized? The next problem is to find some solution to excessive growth.
I would say that was
Terry?
I would say for the first time we're willing as a people to own up to the problem, yes.
Our guest today, Aspen City Manager Leon Wuerl and Vail Town Manager Terry Minger. Thank you very much. My name is George Madsen.
This is Say It, an opportunity to deliver a message or express an opinion during 1 free minute of video time. If you're interested in being on Say It, please contact the Grassroots Television Network at the Wheeler Opera House at 925-4215, or come by their offices Tuesday at noon. And now, Say It.
Hi, I'm Steve Mills. I'm with Colorado Mountain College, running the Aspen office here. Our Aspen office of Colorado Mountain College is located next to the thrift shop in the Wheeler Opera House. We've completed our summer program and are now preparing our program for the fall. Our fall courses will include basically the standard courses we've had in the past. In addition, we will have expanded opportunities for high school completion courses in conjunction with the Aspen School District. Our schedule should be available probably about mid-September. Most of our fall classes will begin the week of September 5th. Anderson Ranch courses will begin the week of October 2nd. For information, we will have our schedule available mid-September, about September 15th. They will be available in our office in the Wheeler Opera House. If you have any questions or if you have any courses you'd like to have during fall quarter, please contact us in the Wheeler Opera House. Our number is 925-7740.
What happened to Carol?
Thank you, Steve. Hi, my name is Ken Hubbard. I'm the Pitkin County Democratic Chairman, and I have the new registration figures for the county as of August 11, the date the books close for the primary. And those are 1,151 Republicans, 1,404 Democrats, and 2,367 unaffiliateds. While I'm gratified that this is an increase of about 1,000 over the last figures available in total registrations, and I'm also gratified that we have more Democrats than Republicans, I am concerned about the number of unaffiliated voters. I'm here to urge the unaffiliated voters to go down and vote in the primary on September 12. They can do this by simply appearing at their polling place and declaring an affiliation at that time and voting for the party that they choose. To be unaffiliated is to be dependent on the parties and the candidates that they select to run in the general election in November. The only way to really participate in the selection of candidates is to affiliate, and I urge everyone to do that on September 12 at the primary.
My name is George Odier. I would like to express my concern regarding the Forest Service regulation in the area. In the last year or two, the Forest Service has provided regulations for the area, which with the strong support of the population, various agencies. The problem now is the enforcement of these regulations. I'm a volunteer patrolman for the game fishing parks, and every month I see many, many violations of these regulations. It is not really the Forest Service fault, and I believe that population, the various official agencies, should support the Forest Service, asking them to provide more enforcement for the area. Very few people know that, but the Forest Service here has only one enforcement officer for the entire upper drainage, which is highly inadequate. And I believe at least two should be provided in order to maintain the protective regulations. I think it should be of concern to all of us. Thank you.
This is Grassroots Network, signing off until November 1st. Those who support us believe in community video, but they have no knowledge nor control over the content of our programs. Tune in again November 1st for Grassroots Network, Channel 12 in Aspen, Colorado. Once more, our sincere thanks to all the individuals and businesses who have made community television in Aspen possible this summer. See you all next season. This is your announcer, Linda Maslow.
$0.02, $0.03 worth of copper is worth several dollars, and yet a silver quarter is 27 cents, something.
Got a belly full of wine. My Majesty's a pretty nice girl. Someday I'm gonna make her mine. Oh yeah, someday I'm gonna make her mine.
going to buy anything, I buy it from a vendor where I know what I'm getting and I can get change immediately.
Eisenhower dollar, which is made out of copper and nickel or stainless steel. It has no particular value.
I prefer to deal with people.
People should follow the principles laid out in Steeler's book, which turns you on to the way to get over all those turnstiles and around all them coins that don't come back. I hate to pay, man. To be truthful with you, I really hate to pay. And if I could get in there without paying, I go through the gate, over the turnstile, around the fence, anything. I don't want
to
pay.
I try to sneak in there, too. Sometimes I use slugs. Within personal things, I'll tell you this, they're going to get more slugs.
And you deal with a machine that is cold and calculating.
But when I put money in, I lose money.
Every machine you put a coin into, you stand a chance of losing your coin and not getting a thing for it, you know that? I think they take in thousands of dollars every year in quarters that just disappear in the machines. People pound it a couple times and then they walk off, you know?
If they're not broken, they keep your money.
Machine can't help you write it, can't talk back, can't give you no consolation.
Everything is going like computers and machines, and I'd rather it be like, you know, just people.
I have a feeling that machines, like McLuhan said, ends up using you. You got to be very careful. It's like trying to be a revolutionary in New York City, so you end up taking the subway.
You don't feel as bad about spending your money if you know that you get satisfaction for it.
Using machine, you quickly take on the needs of the machine. The machine has to work properly, so you take the machine where it can work properly.
Yeah. People are going to start hiking, jacking the machines up, putting them on a dolly, and rolling them away.
I don't know how to handle machines.
I think I'd rather deal with people.
Oh, I don't try to outwit machines.
This program is one of the earliest public access productions in the world, created by the citizens and community of Aspen, Colorado, for the Grassroots Network. Please consider contributing to the restoration and preservation of 200 other Grassroots Network videotapes from the early 1970s. This motion picture record of life, history, and politics in Aspen and the Roaring Fork Valley is in critical need of permanent digital preservation. Please contact John Masters, Executive Director, at 970-925-8000 with your pledge toward this community archive project. The digital restoration and preservation of this program was made possible by generous contributions from John and Catherine Smith, Linda Maslow, Randy Bean, and Andy Stone, and a matching grant from the National Endowment for the Arts in collaboration with the Bay Area Video Coalition, San Francisco.